Okay, so thank you for the introduction. So first, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this great opportunity. And although I'm not sure I'm the best person to explain what will follow, because I see some people in the audience who could probably do better, I'm very happy to take this opportunity to thank you for what you explained to me in the past. So my first exposition to what Cato nicely describes is coming up Gerber effect when you ask him a question was in a letter dated October 2001, I think. It was just after a seminar in Salle W. And indeed, it started by I think that it is possible to prove the statement that you asked about. So this is very So then, at the time, I didn't know you, but I soon understood why some 20 years later we would have this conference to honor your work and also your kindness. So, but 20 years before, I think you were not there when Deligne explained his approach to epsilon factors. So some of you were, I think, but not you. So also he explained to you, I think, the sketch of the idea over lunch. I will try to discuss it now in maybe more details. So so all what I will explain is actually due to Deligne, so I will not attribute the results. But it is but strangely, I mean, on the other hand, it's understanding this and writing the full details is the first step of a project. With Joël Rioux. And of course, the next step should be more interesting, like. For example, understanding the wild case. So here, everything will be tamed today, but of course, we hope to consider the tame case and the wild case. Sorry, and maybe a relative version. So there are hopes for this due to recent work in the rank one by, for example, Takeuchi using those blow-up ideas, and also by Quentin Guignard for the rank one case also. For shift. So I will discuss the setting. So we start with x over k, which is the algebraic closed field. The characteristic of k is p. So x is a proper smooth curve, which I will assume to be connected. We'll fix a ring of coefficients. So it could be either torsion or eladic. So in the torsion case, part of the argument would work with Z mod NZ for N prime to P. But it's simpler to state the result if it is a local ring. But like Z mod L and Z for L different from P. But in part, I mean, at some, at least at one point, it's better to assume that actually this is a field. But I will maybe comment on this when it's a problem. So on X, we assume that we have, so for the etale topology, we have a sheaf of lambda modules of flat, donc a constructible sheaf of lambda modules, or more generally, an object in the with a finite third dimension in DBC of X, because here also, as as Gerber said yesterday, I'm still bounded and even flat in my case. So to this data, we can associate a perfect complex, so the cohomology of X with coefficient in F, which is a perfect complex of lambda modules. And to this complex, of course, we can associate some invariants. So one of them is an integer. This is Euler characteristic, and as you know, this is this integer. So if you take the dimension as a local description. So this is a sum of integer depending on only on the initialization of the curve at the point. Almost all of them are zero, and plus there is a global term which almost doesn't depend on f, and actually does not appear if the virtual rank is zero. So this is the rank of f, which I will usually denote by r, so I mean the generic rank, times the Euler characteristic of the curve. And we can also consider another invariant, which I mean, seems to be kind of trivial if you don't enrich it a little bit. You can also consider the determinant of this complex. So I will usually denote by determinant. I will write epsilon of x, f. So this is this determinant. And the question addressed by the line is to get a similar picture to this one. So we would like to express this. So of course, this is a lambda. This is a line. So maybe I should. So by determinant here, I mean that if I have a complex. With three lambda modules, this is just the tensor product with signs of the individual determinants. So we like to factorize this as a tensor product of lines. Whereas, of course, the epsilon x should satisfy some conditions for this to be interesting. We would like the epsilon x to be of local nature. So it means that it should only depend on f restricted to the strict initialization at the point. This would be trivialized. For almost all point x. So it should be, I mean, of course, we would expect the relevant x to be those for where we have a singularity, plus actually we'll soon see that we will introduce extra data. So for x, which is not a singular point, union some extra data. I will be more precise about this later. And it should be a factorial in F for isomorphisms. And also, it should be multiplicative along exact sequences. And of course, we expect not only this, but that it should lift. So such a decomposition lifts the Grothendieck-Ogg-Shaffarevitch formula, which is this formula here.
The rank no longer appears.
Sorry?
The rank no longer.
Yes, we will see this. Actually, we will see this line as a graded line soon. But yeah, so as actually Faltings explained briefly by this when he was talking about scaling argument, if you consider lambda, which is a unit in the ring of coefficients, then you have the multiplication by lambda, so it's acting on f. So this should induce on the determinant. It will induce a multiplication by lambda to the chi, and we expect so that on the epsilon x, so the local variant, it should be multiplication by the corresponding integers here. I mean, for the the same x.
But it should also be places where it's related to differential forms.
Right? Yeah, yeah. I will talk about differential forms soon.
Because the Dado term is 2 minus 2g.
Yeah. So actually, yeah. So the picture will. I got confused. Yeah, so if the generic rank is zero, I mean the virtual rank is zero, it's simpler. But in general, we'll have some extra attack coming from one form that I will choose in a minute. And actually, so this one form is classical in this following setting. So if x is obtained by base change from a curve over a finite field, and similarly for f0, and if lambda is QL bar. So the action of Frobenius, Frobke action on this. So if you consider, I mean, up to a sign and a shift, the action of Frobenius on this epsilon factor, it should give the numerical product formula. Where the global epsilon factor, here is a number, so this is a constant appearing in the functional equation of the zeta function of the shift. And actually, the local epsilon factors are as defined by Langlands and Deligne, they depend on the choice of an additive character of the field and a one form on X. So at already here, we expect that we should take, and even it was maybe clear here, we should add some extra data to define those lines. So this, questions have been addressed by Deligne around the years 85-80. I think. So we had a geometrical approach to this, which I will explain. I mean, at least part of it. And the advantage of the fact that it is geometric is that it will work for any field k. So we don't assume here, because here also we work over a finite field. The coefficients are could be torsion. But it's not so clear for me that you could. Okay, well, maybe it's a technical question, but whether we can really do this for Z mod L and Z, but probably we can. I think he claims this. Yes. But this approach was successful in the. So it was a success. Successful if F is tame. So we don't have wide ramification. Around 1985, so Gérard Lomont proved this product formula, which I did not state it, but actually he even did it at the level of complexes. But this is in the case where, so this is for over a finite field, and for L-adic coefficients. And as you know, I mean, since then there have been a lot of progress on those questions, including in higher dimensions. So as far as Grothendieck-Okshakovich is concerned, we know that we have this Dobson Kashiwara style formula. So for in any dimension, so Takeshi Saito proved. That we have this index formula. And I also forgot to say that among the things we expect, of course, from such a factorization is that it should set some light on the um, on the effect of torsion on the so this factorization. Should give us a better understanding of those epsilon factors, either numerical or as lines, when you twist by a smooth, so no, I mean unramified, so smooth sheaf of rank, say R, or so we would like to. So it should relate to the epsilon factor of the initial sheaf. And actually, this in general, so this is among the recent progress, Umezaki, Yang, and Zhao, at least at the numerical level, they solved this in a dimension, in any dimension. So here the epsilon factors are the same, defined the same way, but here the numerical variants are just the determinant of Frobenius. So of course this makes sense if you work over a finite field, but in their case they can also work with FL coefficients. So also those questions has been studied by Bellinson. Actually he explained for Deligne's 60th birthday, some approach where he's considering this complex as a homotopy point in some catheterical spectrum, and he wanted to lift this equality to lift this characteristic cycle to express the line in this setting, but it was only in the Betti or Durham setting. So for those problems, it's not completely clear to me why it would be relevant to adopt this high-tech technology. Also, maybe if you consider a relative situation where you can have where the point will then be moving, it could be relevant. Okay, so maybe to be a little bit more precise, I will fix. I will maybe not state exactly the result of Deligne's work on this, but let me say that we will fix omega, which will be a one form. So in H0 of x, omega 1 of x, which is of course non-zero, and maybe it's good to have a notation for, I will denote by t, the divisor of omega. I will assume that, so this is kind of different from Lomon's approach, where Lomon is pushing everything to the line and working on the line. Here, we actually the line is not so nice. We see why in a minute. But so we prefer to work with a genius greater than or equal to 2. Actually, it's basically for some Hartog's principle. I will explain in a minute. So the aim of so what I will explain. So in the Deligne seminar, he constructed some functors. So for started from some sheaf F. So I will not write a flat or anything. But so lambda modules are constructible on X. Let us say because I fixed omega that they are smooth. In a neighborhood of t, and they are tame. Okay, and to this, we will associate some. So we have a functor. We have one functor we already know, which is just the determinant of the cohomology. And as Luc said, we go to the. We don't really see the determinant just as a lambda module of rank 1, but we see it as a graded, so it will be a graded invertible, or graded invertible, graded superline over lambda. So basically, so here graded, it means that the objects here are not only invertible lambda modules, but they are given with some integer, which is a relative integer. So here, for example, the determinant will be the line, the determinant, but placed in degree the Euler characteristic. And super means that for the commutativity, so this is a Picard group, so for the commutativity, we put the signs given by minus 1 to the dd prime if you have L and L prime. So we have this functor, and we like to construct some epsilon x depending on the choice of this one form, omega, so for closed points x. And moreover, this plus trivialization for almost all x's, and of course this factorization. Okay, so so this is what I would like to explain. So for this, maybe remind you some geometrical construction which are quite elementary. So starting from x, which will be still my curve, and some integer d, we can consider the symmetric power of d. So I don't, because I will use this notation a lot, it's better to have a short one. So this is just a symd of x, and of course if so over k if you want, and if locally if x is spec a, as you know, this is the spec of the symmetric tensor, this symmetric tensor of a, which is just a invariant under the permutation group. And we have a similar construction, so whenever you have a sheaf and such a d, so I will not use standard. So d will be, we will use, by dévissage, we will use many d's, and actually it's of course useful to have a variant of this. Whenever you have a family of, so you have a partition of d, so this it will simply be the product of the so symmetric powers. I mean, you have some combinatorics. So this is a kind of product of multiset, and here you map to d, and here this is just the sum, the union, or something I will sometimes write like this. So whenever you have f, so I will say it in the flat case, but in general you have a variant of this. We define a sheaf on this. So here we have something which is of dimension d and smooth. So here we consider this external tensor product, which is a sheaf on x to the d. I consider x the natural quotient map x to the d to the quotient by a symmetric group. And I take the SD invariant. Sorry?
Do you allow torsion synthesis?
Yes.
And invariants are not derived, right?
No. But anyway, I will use. I mean, lambda will be essentially FL or QL here.
It would be the same as if, well, when you take invariants, you could do it either in the classical T structure or perverse T structure, and a priori you'll get different results. Which one are you taking?
Well, here I just take the classical.
And will it be the same as perverse?
I don't know. Actually, you are the one.
I think so. First of all, one is to do it in the, but when f is flat, it goes.
Yeah, no, but I don't want, because I don't think it's really the point here. So
yes.
So if you really want to see the details, because I don't want maybe Martin to be the only one quoting SGA. So if you consider, you look at SGA4, 7, 5, 5, 7 to 8, you will explain what you do in the flat case and what you should do if it's not flat. But I don't want to discuss divided powers versus symmetric tensors. I mean, I think it's not really the point. Yeah. As far as I understand, none of the difficulties come from this. Of course, if you take the wrong definition, it wouldn't work. But yeah, so. So actually, as you proved, if in your article on the Young's conjecture, so we have to be careful that even if f is smooth, it does not imply, it will imply that fd is also smooth, but only on some on the open. On the complement of the diagonals. Of the diagonals where you have collision of points. And as you checked, actually, in general, so this will be just the intermediate extension of this restriction, of course, with the correct shift by D. But this is OK, and this is important because by dévissage, we will somehow reduce to the rank one case for the computation later. But it's OK if the rank is one. Okay. And this, maybe this you can see quite simply because the Stokes, I mean, this problem of non-smoothness at the bad points, because if you consider at the Stoke of F at this effective divisor of degree D, it is isomorphic to the tensor product. Ah, that was the only Japanese. Actually, I'm surprised because I also brought my own Japanese, just in case. Actually, I was too shy to use them, but I noticed that there was exactly the same before, so I took a spare one. So this is a product of this symmetric. We apply the symmetric power functor at Fi on the Stoke. So sorry, so this is not Di, this is Ni. Okay, so it doesn't preserve smoothness, but it's not so bad. So the hypothesis to get so there are some technical hypotheses which are not very we will use them, but by dévissage we could treat the general case easily. Is that we assume from now on that actually we don't want to have a shift with a punctual section with punctual support. So we assume that F embeds into its restriction to the smooth. The direct image of its restriction to the smooth locus. So this is smooth. And I also assume that the H0 of F and the H2 of X are 0. But if you can, if you understand the determinant in the punctual case and in the constant case, then you reduce to this case. So under those assumptions, the Euler characteristic. So here I will use chi a lot, but I would like. It's better if it's a positive integer, so I will just use a shifted one. So chi will be the Euler characteristic of, so the minus the Euler characteristic. So here, it is simply the h1, small h1, so the dimension of x, this dimension. And the determinant we are interested in is then the lambda, so I put minus one. Yeah. So it's lambda, so this is the determinant of this h1. So this is just lambda chi of h1 x f, which we can rewrite. So essentially, this is just the commodity, as we just said here, the commodity of f shifted. So see the, here, this is a complex in degree zero. So if I use fancy notation, this is just of course, it's coincide in this case with the Dold-Kahn extension to complexes of this non-additive functor. And here we can use, so it's just to get a very short proof of what we want to use, essentially the symmetric Kunnett formula. So here we have a formula by Quillen and Illusi, which tells you that this is just, so gamma, I don't like, ouais. Okay, so. So actually, I noticed that in tech, or even in Unicode, you have a small gamma, capital small gamma letter. So, so this divided power functor, also extended with a Dodge-Poupe, sorry, extension of the same complex. But here, we have a shift by 1, and here, you have a shift by chi. And here, we use Delin's Kunnett formula. So by Kunnett formula of Delin, this is just the cohomology of this symmetric power shifted. So here you see that this yeah, we know, yeah. So here this is Delin's Kunnett formula. Symétrique Kunnett formula. Formula. Okay. So here, let me comment. This complex is just concentrated in 1 degree. I mean, depending if you take into account the shift, the shift or not, but it's in 1 degree, degree in degree chi, and the cohomology group is of dimension 1. So it just this is so the determinant we care about. Epsilon of x f is really so we can rewrite this as so I just use this notation for determinants of the cohomology. Okay, I don't care about I will not keep track of the signs plus or minus one, and here really this is nothing else but the determinant of the h of the h chi. So actually we don't even need the determinant because it's already a frank one.
Now, suppose that you don't work with the h0, h2 equals 0. In fact, if your lambda is not a field, then it's a reduction.
Yeah.
So is it the case that canonically this line can be obtained as a determinant of what you wrote in the end?
Ah, yes.
Instead of being, in the end, instead of being a line, exactly, it's a perfect complex, you can still take the determinant of what you get in the end. Like this
R gamma. This here? Yeah. But here we use the fact that chi is.
Yeah, here you use the fact that you have one.
This computation used that it's just H1. Okay.
Yeah, I don't know actually. I mean, yeah. So here we. So we want to localize this determinant. So we like to the idea is to we like the singularities of f to appear somehow. So in Lomon approach, he's using the stationary phase principle. So essentially, it is that whenever you consider function f. And this is here with compact support over R, and if t goes to infinity, this will be small. Say if f prime is non-zero, and actually, so the contribution of the smooth points will be much smaller, so will vanish in comparison to the contribution of singularities, like for example, if I'm right, so if f of x is say lambda x square, you have such a contribution. So what I want to say is that if you want to detect the singularities, you have to have some kind of principle which tells you that you can kill the smooth contribution of the smooth points will disappear. So here, the key observation by Deligne is that you can somehow kill the smoothness for this question, at least over an abelian variety. So there is this important fact that if you take the determinant of the cohomology of some A torsor, where A is an abelian variety of dimension greater than or equal to 1, and if you consider something smooth, then this is canonically isomorphic to lambda. So this will be this is the way we will start to see singularities of the sheaf appear. So the proof of this result is the proof goes by actually some general linear algebra. So the fact that this could be, due to this scaling argument, this is on some A-torsor under some abelian variety. So I just mean a peak. Here it will be the peak of X, but it will be this peak chi on the curve. Yeah, but here it's a general fact. Oh, okay. So this could only be true if your characteristic of for variety zero, which is the case for abelian varieties. So here, essentially, you reduce to show that the determinant of over lambda. So this cohomology can be computed by considering essentially R, which will be a ring of formal power series in 2D generators, at least if you are in characteristic zero. So essentially, you consider some kind of group algebra. So and you reduce to show to the proof of the similar result, i.e. that if you have M, which is an R module, and which is lambda projective of any type, and if M, if you have R, which is an augmented lambda algebra, so actually in this case, such that the immersion, corresponding immersion, is regular of codimension at least C, at least 2, so which will be the case here because 2G is greater than or equal to 2, then we have this fact. And actually, it comes from, so I will not give the details, which are not so difficult. So here, you can compute this by some Kosciuszko complex. So it will depend on some choices. So at least at the level of Kosciuszko complexes, you observe again the fact that the Euler characteristic will be something like 1 minus 1 to the C, so which is 0. But you have some choice of some generating elements in the ideal defining spec lambda. And in the end, to see that this is independent of the choice, you need to check some identity, which is that the determinant, so if you have, say, phi in GLC, the determinant of, so the product of the determinant of the lambda I of phi to the power minus I is 1. And this is why you use that C is greater than or equal to 2, because for 1, it's obviously false. I mean, you have only one term. So so this is what we use to kill the smoothness. So here we'll apply this to the Abel-Jacobi morphism. So the Abel-Jacobi morphism, which is classical already in the rank 1 case, and of course is a subject of all books. So this is just the morphism. I will denote by some integral. So I just map an effective divisor to this, and on the complex side, it will be something like sum of the xi will be up to periods. It will be sum to be. I will send a one form to the sum of some integrals. Okay, so we have this this morphism, which is proper. I will comment on whether it is smooth or not. I mean, in this case, it is smooth. But it will be important to understand it even in a little bit, even in the case where it is not smooth. So we'll push this identity to this torsor. So we want to apply. So maybe before I push this, because to keep notation simpler, I will just say what we can, how we can use this fact to rewrite the determinant of some sheaf which have some only one problem at only one point. So I will keep this notation because otherwise A will be, I mean capital A will be some huge thing which is not relevant for a few minutes. So this fact implies that you can get a description of the global epsilon factor. So I will write A even if it's not, I mean, to be a torsor on abelian variety is not a problem. So here I will assume that I have G, which is smooth, but not everywhere, because it's just the case we treated, but over just punctured A. So A, so this is A minus only one point. Okay, so here, by some Hartog's principle, so some sense, so because G is greater than or equal to 2, so here I have my smooth, so here this is A, here I have a point a, small a, so here I have G which is smooth, so this is a sheaf, a constructible sheaf of lambda modules on A, but it is smooth everywhere but at A. So it will have a smooth extension to the wall A. So for this extension, I know that the determinant is trivial, and I use the exact sequence, I mean the triangle, and I get that this determinant is up to a sign, or maybe. This is the determinant of the cone of the fiber of G at A to the generic fiber. Well, actually, I think there is a minus one, but it's not relevant here. Okay, so I just write the exact, I just write a triangle, and I get this. So for this, I mean, just a rewriting of. So I would like to rewrite this to. So there are two ways to rewrite this. Actually, we use a second one, but mostly. But it's probably for this question, including things I will not discuss. But for example, yeah, I mean. For example, here we choose omega, so there will be also the question of understanding how the epsilon depends on omega. So certainly we cannot restrict completely to the case where a base is of dimension one. So this viewpoint is maybe relevant here. So one way to understand this is to say that this will be the stoke at one point of a complex. So actually this is nothing else but. So this GA, I mean this map, is just a fiber at the point of so this is a fiber at the point eta. I will just write eta for generalization. So here, this is a point. So here, naturally, we see that we want a space whose points are given by pairs, where one is a generalization of the other. So there is a topos here, which is just whose points are pair A, B, B being a generalization of A. And it comes equipped with two projection to A, P1, which is the first point, the special point, and P2, this is a generalization of it. And also there is a map like this. And so this description tells you that what we care about is given by some vanishing cycles construction, at least for the identity map on this kind of space. Okay, so there is a relative version, and we could rewrite what will follow in this relative version, but because it will not be useful today, I will not explain it in more details. Another way to write this is to consider the case. So here, if you consider so the germ, locally around around A, you assume that you have a map T to A1 0, which is smooth. So it means defined on a neighborhood of a small a. And mapping, so a to 0. Yeah. So here, using the fact that the vanishing cycles vanish in the smooth case, you see that this cone can also be understood as the fiber of this complex, which lies on the fiber over zero, the at A. So essentially, you have those two descriptions here, and they are essentially the same. Okay, so this is a general and completely formal. What is specific to the situation is that we do have such an almost smoothness result. So here is a theorem of the line. The statement is the following. So that for all n strictly greater than chi, then the pair, the Abel-Jacobi map, and this symmetric power is locally acyclic. So I will use this notation for acyclic. So I don't want to remind you what it means. I mean, many of you know, but essentially, it will mean that the analogous vanishing cycles vanish, and it will imply that direct images by this proper map. Sorry, those sheaves are smooth. So essentially, the situation we discussed, I erased, but here we have something. We have something over an Abelian variety, and this is smooth everywhere. So here, I don't want to recall the definition, but it's a local acyclicity already, which existed even before the auto-induction by Deligne of those complexes. And it's kind of similar to Milner's definition. But if you just go so for n equals chi, so here something interesting happens at a very specific place. So here we have this morphism. So the same conclusion is locally acyclic, so over this punctured variety. So here we have to remove one point, which I will denote by KF. And KF is just R, so the rank of generic rank of the sheaf, times the class of the canonical divisor, the omega 1, plus the sum of AP P, which is of degree exactly chi. And if we want to localize a bit more this construct, so actually, if you stop here, you can understand this epsilon factor. So the epsilon we care about is some epsilon on some fiber over this point here of the Abel-Jacobi map. So we'll have a projective space of dimension chi minus g. And here we will have by restriction, some vanishing cycles above it. But it's not yet very local. It lies on a projective space. And there is a variant of this. Actually, the proof of this, we can do the same thing. So here, if we consider this situation, so if we consider P, chi, kf, so exactly what we did before, a1, 0, t, and I denote by, I will give notation in a minute to dt. So here we have the same result, but no, sorry, but it's not the same morphism. So I consider the composition of this Abel-Jacobi map to the line.
So this T is defining a neighborhood or an entire neighborhood of the point?
No, it's just a neighborhood.
Ah, okay, a neighborhood. Yeah.
So this is locally acyclic, except maybe, except. At a point here, so here we have just we'll isolate in this projective space one point, which will depend on f and omega. So omega is dt, which is the same, essentially the same thing, but oh. No, but I, okay, I will take it after. So here we take RT. So T is a divisor of omega plus the same APP. So here it belongs to this, and this is in the fiber over KF.
Sorry, I didn't understand what's written in A prime? So it's 2?
So 2 prime, sorry? No, where?
Two prime, yes.
Two prime is the same statement, but here, so here we have the Abel-Jacobi. So here we have the Abel-Jacobi map. Yeah. We can consider this morphism. So we have some local acyclicity result, except over a specific point, which we map to zero here. And here we consider the composition, the composed map. So here I should say that I restrict this. I mean, this is defined locally, so.
Oh, it's T
composed
with.
Sorry, yes. So maybe I should not. Okay, this is just T, the composition.
Is it reads as 2 and then.
Uh-huh. Ah, sorry, yes. Yeah. Okay. So so once you have this result, you obtain that the, up to a sign, you obtain that your epsilon factor. You can rewrite this, as I said, as some kind of still. Quite local. I mean, once you made the choice of a generalization of KF, but you can rewrite this as the fiber of this those classical vanishing cycles. So classical in the sense that the base of dimension one. So this is really this at of the composed map. So here we have something, so here we, I mean the fiber of this. And here this is completely, so here you see that already this is completely localized the determinant because it's only dependent on f around the singular points. So the p's where you have, so here this is, as Takeshi reminded us, the difference because you're in the time case between the generic and the special rank, and around T. But around T, we assume from the beginning that we are smooth around T. So here, what's going on is simple. Although it does contribute, but in a simple way. So how do we prove this this theorem? So we do that by some dévissage. So the first observation, so we want to prove, I mean, we two of them at the same time. So we consider this morphism locally at a point. So we consider a point here in the nth symmetric power. And
F is tame or not?
So F is tame everywhere.
Ah, from the beginning. Okay.
Sorry, tame here. But it will appear in a minute because it enters the proof, unfortunately. Okay. So, so it'll. at a divisor sum of n row, x row, so points which are not a priori related to the previous ones. So essentially, it will be just x given by the product, so ital locally, the same thing as the product of the symmetric powers, because I assume that those points are distinct. Do we have a name for this? Okay, so it's not. And here, the sheaf I consider is the external tensor product of the sheaves. So I okay, this is very formal. So this is one first fact. The second fact is that if I consider the situation locally at a point of where we have a singularity, here we have an abelian fundamental group because this is because the sheaf is tame. So it implies that we will have a filtration of the sheaf. So here I'm working at the level of x, so look eta locally. So here I skip some detail. I mean, I can assume that I have, if I want to prove result for QL coefficient or QL bar, I reduce to the torsion case, in the end to FL, but maybe I will need some extension of scalars to have eigenvalues or whatever, but okay, I'll skip this. So here, essentially, you have filtration on F such that the graded quotient is the same as essentially a sum of extension by zero of smooth sheaves on the punctured curve. I mean, so this is smooth on the initialization, plus the same thing on rank one, plus the same thing, but where I have smooth sheaves everywhere. So here I have the rank of F minus minus B, minus A, sorry. So essentially, I can reduce, in this time setting, I can consider essentially direct sums of extension by zero and smooth things. So here I use the fact that whenever, so this is another general fact, that whenever we have an exact sequence and I want to compute this sheaf n, I will again have a graduation. So ultimately I can reduce computation to the case where I have, I consider sheaves coming from both factors. So here this is on x a b. So here this is for a plus b equals n. So essentially, using this, I will reduce my size to computation with sheaves which are either smooth, so essentially lambda, or extension by zero of lambda. And in this case, essentially, I will reduce to some very geometric statement. So essentially, I know that if I consider something, a smooth morphism, or something smooth, because I want to prove some local cyclicity, I have this is zero. And I need to extend this to some very classical facts that, for example, you can handle a similar situation when. So essentially, whenever I have a family over a base, when I have a smooth divisor, and I consider, see, I have K, and I consider some extension by zero of lambda, I will have the same kind of result. So essentially, to prove vanishing of the vanishing corresponding vanishing cycles, I'm reduced So this is the kind of things you can see in HDS7 already. And by dévissage, it reduces to the essentially the proper smooth base change. You are reduced to check some smoothness of some divisors appearing in the stratification. Can I just finish in 2 minutes? Appearing in the stratification of your sheaf. So here you have. So you are reduced to geometrical to geometry. So here you have two cases. So you have the general case here of the statement I wanted to prove, where the base is a Picard scheme, and you have the one over A1. So in this to handle this case over the big basis, essentially you need to understand what is the differential of the Abel-Jacobi map, and you wonder if this is for this, and because the divisor which will appear will be essentially of this form or product of this form. So essentially, you need to understand this. So this is essentially H0 of x O d over x. So here at d. So here it's essentially the tail of Laurent series, and here I am mapping to residues. I cannot write it precisely, but essentially here, if you have if d is AP, here you will have things like A to O divided by Z, etc. And here you map this and this tangent space to the map sending the one from omega to the residue of F omega. But here you can look at this in a more abstract way, and here you can check that this is a commodity map. So here it will reduce the smoothness to the question of showing that this image, some kind of image, is big, and ultimately you will just use the fact that whenever you have H0 of x omega 1 of minus d, it is zero if the degree of d is strictly bigger than 2g minus t do. So you do some combinatorics. And in this case, in the other case, essentially you need to understand what happens whenever you consider such a sheaf. So here this is we have a situation over A1. So here you have x b, and you can analyze this and understand exactly that if b is bigger than a, you don't get any problem, because the divisors which will appear will always be of dimension strictly positive, and they will be smooth over A1 due to our assumption, because omega is not zero at the singular points of F. And also because, okay, well, maybe I will not explain more, but you really compute this and you understand why you have only this problem for B equals A. Okay, thank you. Sorry for.
We have time for the question. Okay. So when you explained to me this approach, so there was some technical question about you decomposing it to contribution of corner maps to there was these maps of smaller peak di to and then you, the map is not exactly the function, is not exactly the sum of certain things, but only function.
Yeah, yeah. So actually, yeah. So what I did not explain here is that so here we are still far from. I mean, it's not exactly the decomposition. So here we just localize. So this only explains why it will only depend on f locally around each point. It doesn't explain why it is a tensor product of local contribution. So for this, you need to use Tom Sebastiani type theorem. But for but the details are not so clear yet actually, because
basically some kind of theorem for Tom Sebastiani. Tom Sebastiani, you don't need any team. So then.
Yeah. No.
So basically, you have this symmetric product and the peak, and then maybe one. So when you look at the cycles for composition.
Yeah, but what's.
I need to have some formula for intermediate things.
No, but yeah. But what if I'm saying that already, if whenever you consider the projection to A1, what is naturally occurring is, I mean, there are a couple of questions which are still to be rechecked actually. So whenever you have XA goes to peak AA and XB, so this is what I denoted by a comma previously, peak B, and here you have the sum. And here you consider the map to A1.
Yeah.
So here you don't, I mean, this map is not additive. So you don't have the fact that T composed with the sum of the Abel-Jacobi. But actually, infinitesimally, you have. So you first need to improve a little bit the classical statement of Tom Sebastiani, which classically do not take this into account. Although I think it's supposed to be true, but it's not written down.
Okay, so
And also,
to use the theory of vanishing cycle in several variables.
Yes, so that's why I kind of advertise the fact that there is such a theory, which is why we have some hope to improve maybe what was known at the time. And also, here I was not maybe, so there is already this problem because I was expecting those epsilon x to depend on omega. But here, for example, the construction. Here I wrote this, but actually I'm cheating a little bit because I used t to define this. So I use t such that dt, I don't know what it is, okay, dt equals omega. So, but actually it should be t, but the conjecture is that even in the white case, actually those kind of things should only depend on dt. And actually the situation is a little bit more complicated when we want to understand in detail, which we did not, and so far we did not succeed yet, with a classical numerical epsilon product formula, because here we have it will depend on omega, but the contribution, at least if the virtual rank is not zero, the contribution of the omega is more slightly different than the contribution in the classical numerical setting, because for example, if you consider the vanishing cycles of a family of x goes to lambda x squared. So essentially, this is something we get when you integrate. You have the one form lambda z dz. And naturally, at the point of t, so t is the support of the divisor of omega. So we have something very simple because f essentially is smooth, so there is no big problem. But still, we have this contribution here. And whenever you turn, so this is of rank one, but whenever, so you have a line. But whenever you turn over around zero, you will get some monodromy. Plus or minus one monodromy, which is kind of new phenomena, I think. I mean, so it's not clear yet, actually.
More questions?
In the theorem of Dolin on this local cyclicity, is it expected to also reach the wild case, or does it fail there?
And you mean.
So what is the statement?
You mean the.
What do you expect? You can control the
No, but I think the Dolin, we expect that, for example, we expect that the global contribution should again can be break down into local contribution of the so we have
the acyclicity.
Yeah. Does this? I don't know. But we expect at least locally, but probably, I would say yes.
Okay.
But locally, we expect to have this kind of baby case situation here. We expect the same kind of things happen with of course, the Swan conductor, and that it will only be there will be only contribution in cosmological degree A. That it should not depend on dt, that it should be tame also. But I don't know. So, I mean, so this is actually what was known by Dolin at the time.
Okay, so let's thank Fabrice again.